Hey everybody, Shia, Mike here. I wanted to talk this morning. I just got done with my my pajama class on Saturday morning. You can see I'm a little sweaty. I got a nice little workout in with everyone that joined us. So thank you everyone who joined us and got the workout in. All right, I wanted to talk about practicing. So this I asked my students when this whole thing started where we had to be closed to take video of their kata and send me video so I could look at the video of the kata and make some corrections on it and help them out a little bit with it. And what I've noticed is I get a lot of videos of students doing kata from start to finish, So that's great because that's gonna help with memorizing the kata, and I think that's awesome and I want you to keep doing that. But I also wanna teach you how to practice the right way. So think of it about like riding a bike, right? My son's been riding his bike for a while. Now he's been riding since last year. He learned how to ride that bike without training wheels. So he rides without training wheels now. He's doing a really awesome job at riding the bike. So he saw me on my bike do a skid. Now a skid is where you either hit the brake, sometimes it's called a power slide. You hit the brake and you turn the wheel and the back tire kind of slides out, right? And he wanted to learn how to do that. So I taught him how to do that. And on the first day, he kind of got it and was doing it and he was working on it, right? And the next day it got even better, and the next day it got even better, and now he could kind of like be going one way and he could hit the brake and he could turn that wheel and he could almost turn all the way around and face the other way and start riding. Okay, and my neighbor came out and looked at me doing this and teaching him this and looked at me like, do you really want to be teaching him that? And I said, absolutely. And they looked like, what? Like, you're going to teach him all these tricks? What if he gets hurt? And my thing is if he learns how to do this power slide, he's going to have more control over the bicycle when he's riding it than somebody who doesn't learn how to do that. All right. So if I'm riding down the street now and a car backs out of the driveway and I didn't see it and I know how to do that and I turn my wheel, I'm going to know how to bring the back end out and stop the bike instantly, faster than the brakes could ever stop the bike. Right. So I'm going to learn to have more control over my bicycle. And the more I ride that bicycle, and the more I do these different things on that bicycle, the more control I'm gonna have over it. Like who's, God forbid I'm riding my bicycle or my son's riding his bicycle and something happens where he has to react fast. Who's gonna have better control to react fast? Somebody who rides their bicycle every single day and learns a couple of little tricks, or somebody who rides their bicycle once a week, right? I think the person that rides that bicycle once a week is gonna fall off and get damaged a lot worse than somebody who's riding the bike every day and somebody who's learning how to do some tricks on the bike. Okay, so yes, I'll teach him little tricks right now that are age appropriate for his age level that'll help him learn how to control the bike better than somebody who's not learning that stuff. So the same thing goes for karate or any sport, right? The other day we were playing basketball and I was bouncing the basketball with my left hand. Now I'm a righty. My left hand, and I haven't bounced a basketball in a long time. My left hand, I felt like I didn't know what I was doing with it. So what did I do when my son was playing with something else and my daughter? I grabbed the basketball, and just with my left hand, I bounced it 100 times, right? And next time I do it, it might be 150, because I didn't like that bouncing that basketball. It didn't feel as comfortable as it did when I was playing basketball a lot more, right? So the more you practice something, the more the signal going to the brain gets stronger. Okay, and the more that signal gets stronger, the more we call it in martial arts muscle memory. It's a neurological signal, but we call it muscle memory. The more you do it over and over again, okay, the stronger that signal gets. Now, what's nice about that, especially with kata, if I'm practicing a kata, and let's say I'm practicing pinyon form five, and I bow, us, pinyon form five, sensei, and I step out, right, and I'm supposed to be doing a mid block, and I'm supposed to be in a back stance. So I step out, I fold my arms, I step out to the side, I do my mid block, and I look down, or I don't, right? One would be bad if I didn't realize, but I'm not in a back stance right now. My front foot is not pointed where it's supposed to be. So now I go back, I don't continue the kata, I go back to the beginning, and I practice that part over and over again until I can get that foot pointed where I want it, right? And I might do it again. All right, that didn't feel comfortable. I fold again. Boom. Did I drop my weight enough? Am I in a good enough stance? Let's do it again. And then I do that again, and I'll do that as many times as it takes for it to feel comfortable for me, and so that way I can do it without thinking about it. So that way when I start that kata, I don't want to be thinking about how to fold my arms for my mid block. I don't want to be thinking about how to step. And the only way to do that is to practice it over and over. When I get comfortable with that move, now I can do the next one. You know what? I didn't like the way my upper body turned. My stance shouldn't change, but my upper body didn't feel comfortable on that. So I fold my arms again. I look, I step, boom, mid block, I punch. And I might do that 5 times before I go on to the next move. It's all about, one, getting the kata memorized to a point where you don't have to think about how to do the kata when you're doing it. The less you have to think about how to do the kata when you're doing it, now you learn what's called bunkai. Bunkai is the application, what every move in the kata could possibly do. And katas are just examples like a math textbook. You don't have every example of math in your textbook that you could possibly ever do. The book would be infinite. It would be too big to understand. So the kata gives you an example of what block and a strike. Could I change the strike if I wanted to in application? Absolutely. That would depend on how close or far away the person is to me, what strike I would do. When I practice the kata, I practice the kata the exact way my sensei teaches me to practice it. Doesn't matter what style of martial arts I'm doing, I practice the kata the exact way my sensei tells me to teach about it. Not because I want to respect my sensei. Okay, I practice it the exact way I'm supposed to practice it to learn about my body, right? If I can get that front foot straight on that mid block, okay? If I can get that front foot pointed where I want it to point, I'm learning how to control my body, right? If I can't get it straight, I gotta keep working on it until I get it straight, okay? That's gonna teach me how to control my body. And when I learn to control my body, one, I'm gonna be better at anything I do. But if I learn to control my body, then when I need to defend myself or I need to do something, I'll be able to control maybe that other person too, right? So the idea is to practice it over and over again, but don't just practice a kata from start to finish. So if I was doing Pian Fum 5, I'm gonna go fold, look, mid block, punch. The next move is draw up. If I don't like the way that feels, I'm gonna go back to my punch, and now I don't wanna come up as high with my head. Then I go the other way, mid block, punch. Is my foot straight? Yes. Is my stance good? Yes. Is my punch in the right spot? Am I looking straight or am I hunched over, right? Is everything perfect on here before I go here? All right, now double arm block. Boom. Okay, that's good. Now I'm going to step forward and go into my X block. I'm going to pull my hands back. I'm going to come up. I'm going to chop. I'm going to step forward and punch, right? I'm going to work on these techniques until they're comfortable. If I'm doing a kata and I'm off balance during the kata, or my movements don't feel right to me, I should go back to the beginning, or at least back to the last move, and do it again. Why? Because again, I wasn't doing it right. It didn't feel right. It didn't feel comfortable. And if you imagine thinking of kata as it is, self-defense techniques, it's ways you can defend yourself in a confrontation, okay? And if I'm not comfortable doing it by myself in the air, in a form, right, as a routine, how am I gonna feel comfortable doing any moves against somebody else who's got their hands on me or is trying to hurt me? Okay, I'm not gonna make those moves come out very well against an opponent if I'm not comfortable or balanced doing it on my own, okay? So there's a million different reasons to do kata. Some people just do kata for the health benefits, which is fine. You get a great workout, you can get in shape, and necessarily don't need to do the kata right to get in shape. You could do the kata and be all over the place, right? But you get a workout, you sweat, you move strong, you move hard. Now, is that front foot pointed perfectly gonna help me in a fight? No. Is doing my kata perfectly gonna help me in a fight or a self-defense situation? No, I could pick up a chair and crack somebody with it, right? It doesn't mean that you're gonna do the moves any better in a self-defense situation if you're doing them perfect during your kata. But it's gonna make you understand your body better. And it's gonna allow you to get to the next level of training. Whereas the more I practice that kata over and over again and practice each individual move over and over again so I don't have to think, right? If I get to a point in the kata and I get here and now I have to think about what comes next, that's great for the beginner mindset, right? I have to think about what am I doing next? I'm bringing my hands up, I'm bringing them out, right? And that's okay when I'm first learning the kata. But I can't think about what comes next, and then I can't visualize applying that technique if I'm thinking about how to do that technique, okay? So the second step is once you learn how to do the kata and you have the kata to the point where we can, as senseis, we can say go or clap a target and you could just bust out the kata strong and hard and perfect stances and good balance and you feel comfortable doing it, without thinking about how to do the kata, now we can slow you back down. You have the applications and our self-defense moves. You're learning the bunkai already. And now you can start to visualize when I'm doing that kata, how that person's attacking me and how I'm using that kata and what the moves mean and which, when I'm going in a certain direction, what that means. Now, I believe, and I've learned this from other martial artists, Ian Abernathy is one of them that I listen to online, that the directions that we go in the kata does not mean that there's attackers coming from all different directions. To me, that's nonsense. It's always been nonsense to me. What the kata means to me is that's the direction I go against my opponent or the person I'm defending myself against. So if I'm turning sideways in the kata or I'm going to the side in the kata, then I'm moving to the side of my opponent. Okay, if I'm going behind me, then I'm getting behind my opponent. If I'm moving forward, then I'm moving forward towards my opponent, okay? Towards the person who's trying to attack me. That's, to me, what the directions in the kata mean, not somebody's coming from this side. Okay, now my spider senses a tingle and somebody's coming from the other side. Absolutely not, okay? That's not what the kata means to me, okay? So when we're practicing these things, we can start to visualize, as long as we've worked a certain move with a partner already, okay, we can visualize what that move does as we're practicing the kata and we visualize the attacker coming at us. And now we're going to start to develop that muscle memory of how to use this move. And that's where self-practice, okay, comes in very handy with times like now where we can't have a partner and we can't work with a partner. Okay, if I didn't know what the kata does, then I should still be practicing the kata to get the moves down, to get my stances down, make the kata feel comfortable, like riding that bicycle. So if something happened where you needed to move out of the way or jump off the bike or whatever happens, or if you get a flat tire, you don't go over the handlebars on that bicycle because you rode that bicycle so much that your body will react naturally and keep you from getting hurt. Whereas somebody who's a beginner bike rider, right? When my son first rode his bike, I was chasing him down the block once training wheels got off because I didn't want him to fall, right? So your parents are running next to you trying to keep you from falling off that bike, okay? That's because you haven't rode it enough yet. When you ride it enough, you'll get to a point where even if you fall, it isn't going to be as bad as somebody who's just learning to ride that bike or somebody who rides the bike once a week or once or twice a season every spring when they first take their bike out, okay? So we want to get to that point where we become an expert at what we're doing. And you don't need to practice 9-10 katas, okay, to do that. You can practice one kata over and over again, learn your stances, learn your technique, feel balanced, feel strong. Can you put power and generate power on each movement? Feel strong with each movement. And all that's going to do is help you learn about your body, okay? The worst thing to have is to do the kata and you know you're supposed to be in a back stance and you don't know that you're not in a back stance. So you know that you're supposed to be in a front stance and you don't know that you're supposed to be in a front stance, right? Like our high block is supposed to be up above our nose. My teacher always made us do it with our forearm forward, not like this. He wanted it like this, so the bone is here, okay? And we were supposed to see the crook of our wrist over the bridge of our nose without moving our head, and our high block supposed to look like this. Now, if we know that it's supposed to look like this, but we're doing our katas and it's over here, and we don't realize it's over here, we haven't practiced enough, right? We want to practice it more so we know where our hands are supposed to go, we feel where they're supposed to go, and at some point, you'll be doing the kata, and somebody to the naked eye, when they look at that kata, they're going to go, wow, that kata looks great, and you're going to say, thank you, but there was 3 or 4 spots where I was off balance because I felt it. I got to go practice it again. Right? And you'll start to get that feeling. And it feels great once you can get that. When you do your kata and you know what it's supposed to feel like, you know it's strong, you know it's powerful, and you won't need anybody to tell you how strong it looks because you'll know, you'll feel it. But if you're doing your kata and you do a move and you feel like you're off balance or you feel like you're gonna fall over, go back to the beginning, do it again. Start again and get that practice in. Think of any professional athlete, okay? How many times they must do drills over and over and over again to get to that level. And as black belts, okay, first degree, second degree, third degree, fourth degree, right? We should be at that level, all right, of movement with our body. We should be able to do our kata as well as a professional basketball player plays basketball, as well as a professional baseball player plays baseball, right? As well as a professional hockey player plays hockey. You wouldn't take 10 slap shots and miss the net and go, okay, I'm done practicing for today. You'd probably stay out there and do that slap shot over and over again, or that wrist shot, or whatever you're doing over and over again until you start getting that puck into the net, right? You keep practicing until you got it in there. Well, that's the way we're supposed to practice kata. We're not supposed to just memorize kata, okay? That's the first part of practicing it. We want to get to a point where we become an expert in the performance of that kata. Then we learn the applications, the bunkai, and the underlying principles. And then we start to learn how to use that kata and how to have that kata help us for self-defense. And it meshes, right? Some people say, well, the kata don't have to be perfect to do self-defense, so I don't have to practice the kata perfect. I'm just going to go through the movements hard and strong and powerful, and I don't have to make the kata perfect. You're right, you don't. But I believe that the cleaner our techniques are, okay, and the faster I can get my techniques, and the better my techniques are, the less telegraphed I am when I'm doing something, the harder it's going to be for the other person to see me doing it, right? Then if I'm sloppy, it's good. They're going to see it right away. If I've got good technique, it's going to be harder for them to see it coming. Okay, so that's the idea. Practice, practice, practice. But I wanted to give you a video on how to practice the right way. Okay, so don't just do the kata from start to finish one time and your practice is done, right? And then do 5 or 6 katas. I'd rather you do one kata 20 times and break it down so you're doing each move 5 times before you go on to the next one. Know the stances you're supposed to be in and make sure you're in those stances before you move on to the next move. Make sure that the transitions from one move, so if I'm in a double arm block here and I'm doing pian from 5 and I'm supposed to go here, make sure that that transition from that stance to this stance, okay, feels good and is balanced. If I'm doing this and I'm like falling all over the place, go back and do it again. Make sure that that transition from one stance to the next stance feels comfortable before you go on to the next move. If you step into that thrust punch and you wobble, go back, do that chop again, and do that thrust punch again until it feels comfortable. And if you do that, I practice you, even without a sensei standing next to you, making sure that you're doing everything perfectly right, your kata will get better. But if you just practice the kata from start to finish, all you're going to do is memorize the kata, and if you're not doing the movements correctly and right, you might memorize some bad habits. So I want you to break down your kata. Act like you're the sensei. Act like you're doing the kata, and you're the sensei standing right in front of you correcting your kata. And when you get that, okay, it'll be great. It'll be great for you, okay, and it'll be easier for you to learn things. And one more thing with that is videotape yourself doing it. Because if you don't know what you look like doing your karate, okay, doing your movements, how are you gonna make corrections? So if you videotape yourself and you know that this chamber is supposed to be back here like this on your thrust punch, and it's over here, and you see that, and you're, oh, you know what, my hand's not in the right spot. I'm gonna fix that, okay? This hand's supposed to be in the center of my sternum, right, like this, and your hand's over here. Oh, you know, I gotta fix that. You can start to examine a videotape of yourself doing the kata, okay, and you can make that kata better, because now you'll start to, in your mind, you'll correct this. And the next time you go back and practice the kata, it won't be much work to put this hand where it's supposed to be instead of over here, right? You'll get it back and keep your back straight and keep your stomach tucked in, right? Keep everything nice and strong. Good posture during kata, right? You don't want your shoulders rolled out and your lower back bent over like this while you're doing your kata, okay? So I really hope that this video helps. I hope you'll take the suggestions in this video and use them to practice your kata. And again, if you're sending me videos, keep sending me videos, okay? You can send them to me through email, you can send them through Messenger, on Instagram, you can send them to me. It doesn't matter where you send them to me. I will look at them and I will get back to you with some feedback. I'll let you know that you're doing great on certain points, but I'll also help you out with some corrections on other points. Don't be embarrassed by the video, okay? You can send it to me privately and we're not going to share it. But even if you don't do that, at least for your own practice, right? If you're not willing to do the kata and shoot a video of yourself doing the kata and look at it yourself, then you don't really want to get better at what you're doing, right? So you got to do this for you, not for me, not for the school, not because the other students are doing it, right? If you find out all the other students in the school aren't doing this, don't be like, well, I'm not doing it. Well, why should I do it? You're doing it for yourself. You're doing it for your martial arts, not for them. You're doing it for you. We do things because it's going to help us. And in turn, if we get better, we'll be able to help other people. Not, well, Joey didn't do his kata and send a video to Sensei, so I'm not doing it. My best friend didn't do it, so I'm not doing it. Don't think like that. Think for yourself. Do your kata, practice your kata, take a video of you doing your kata, look at the video, go practice the kata again. Make the corrections that you see are wrong. And if you need help with seeing those corrections, then send me the video and I'll help you, okay? So I hope this video helps. Keep doing a great job. We'll be back on the mat soon enough, all right? We'll be back together training soon enough, all right? I miss you guys. I'll talk to you soon.